Hi, this is David with EdgeStar Technical Support. Today we're going to be talking about the TWR215ESS. This is our dual zone 21 bottle wine cooler. We're going to cover features, basic operation, and some minor troubleshooting. All right, here we have the TWR215ESS thermoelectric wine cooler. This is a dual zone unit, and as you can see, it has stainless steel trim, stainless steel handle, and if we open up the door, we see that we have four racks on the bottom, two on the top. Our temp ranges on this one, the upper zone only runs to 44, and the bottom zone will run down to a low of 50. We have about a 10 degree range on each one, so we're roughly at about 55 at the top and about 60 at the bottom when it's running. So, and we, of course, we have our controls here in the front. This is our light for each zone. Each one has its own independent, and as you can see, I left the bottom one on there. So those are our light controls, and these are our temperature controls. This one here corresponds to the upper side. This one corresponds to the lower side. So we can go up and down. Now, of course, I've got this one bottomed out, but as you can see, it's blinking, and I'm going to hit it again. While it's blinking, it's setting your temperature choice into memory. So once it stops blinking and it shows what the temperature is that you've set it at, then we're good to go. It saves that particular setting. Same thing on our upper zone. I can raise the temperature up. I'll raise it to 46 and it blinks. It's saving it now. And now it will run until it hits 46. So it will actually slow the fans down. We'll have the same cooling effect, but the fans aren't going to circulate as much air, and it'll eventually raise that temperature up a couple of degrees. A couple of things to note here. The door on this unit is not reversible, and the handle does not come pre-installed. There's also an adjuster leg at the bottom. We're going to talk about that. It's a really easy adjustment. You have three fixed legs, which are pretty large in size, and you have one small fixed leg, which is here in the corner. And as a matter of fact, that leg is on this lower door hinge. It is not attached to the body of the unit in any way. So when you pull this unit out of the box, what you're going to find is that you're going to have a lot of packaging material in here. There's going to be blue tape holding these shelves, some foam. You'll have the handle in here as well. It's going to be packed in a plastic bag along with your owner's manual. So you need to unpack it very carefully. And by the way, while we're talking about the shelves, they do come out and they have a bit of a stop to them so that your wine doesn't come flying out. And also, as you can see, if we don't have the door back a little bit, we can't get the shelves out. That brings me to another point. This unit is a freestanding unit. We don't want to enclose it in a cabinet that can cause overheating and eventual unit failure. And then we'll end up having to repair it. So we need to leave this in an area where there's no obstructions. So on a countertop like this is ideal. So if we could pull the shelves out, and they have a bit of a stop there, and you basically tilt the back of the shelf up and then pull the shelf all the way out. When you go to put the shelf back in, you're going to line up your slots, and then it just pushes back in, and you'll feel when it hits that stop because it goes up a little bit and then drops back down. So now our shelves are all in place, and that's it for the interior of the unit. And also, by the way, on the door, you're going to have to unwrap your handle. As I said, your handle is going to be wrapped in a plastic bag, and you need to actually install it. To do that, it's really easy. What you're going to do is you're going to take this gasket, and as you can see, I'm taking my thumbs, and I get down on it as far as I can, and I'm going to pull it straight out. And then I can kind of grab it and just work it out of the groove. You have a screw here at the bottom and one here at the top, and all you need is a Phillips screwdriver. So what you would do is you would take your screws, which actually should already be pre-installed in the door already, by the way. But what you'll do is you'll tighten your screws up, just like that. You'll line the handle up, get it started, tighten them up. You don't want to over-tighten them. You'll strip the door and strip the handle as well. Once you're done installing the handle and it's tight, then you can take your thumbs, just like this, and you're going to work that gasket back into place. Now, only remove as much gasket as you need to accomplish the task. You don't want to take too much gasket off. Okay, so let's talk about the back of the unit here. As with all appliances, occasionally we're going to need some maintenance, and I want to cover some of those issues. First of all, in our previous part of the video here in the beginning, I told you that the unit is a freestanding unit, and that is indeed true for more reasons than one. Number one, the back of this unit here on the sides, right here at the back, there's some vents that run down the width of the unit here, and they generate a tremendous amount of heat while they run. So that's the primary reason why we want to keep this unit in open air. Secondly, the way the unit airflow works, we need to make sure it's kept in an open space, because what happens is the air gets sucked in through these vents, these two here in the back, and it becomes expelled out the sides. So we need to make sure that we have that continuous circulation, so it's kind of in and out, in and out. So what we're going to do here is cover a little bit of maintenance. The first thing we need to talk about is cleanliness, because it's important these units are kept clean all the time. About every 6 months, we're going to want to come in here and really kind of clean house, do a spring cleaning on it, and you'll be good for another 6 months to maybe even a year. And that depends on your home, what kind of environment the unit's installed in. So we might be able to stretch that interval a little bit, but we're not going to really want to stretch it beyond a year. So first thing we're going to do is basic maintenance. You need to make sure the cabinet's clean, it stays wiped down. If there's any buildup in these side vents, it needs to be removed. Now, you can use a vacuum cleaner with a brush attachment, and that'll work just fine. So what you need to do here on the back is you actually remove these filters. You can wash these with detergent and warm water. You need to make sure that before you put these back in, they're completely dry and they don't have any soap residue on them, because that can cause the contaminants, the dust, the dirt, to actually clog it up even faster, because that dirt will actually adhere to the filter. So we don't want that to happen. To get these filters out, it's really easy. You have two tabs here at the top. You're going to press down and then pull it out. And as you can see, it's got two little tabs here at the bottom, and then we've got our two big tabs here at the top. Now, as you can see, it's not completely open. It does have a secondary screen. We need to make sure that's clean as well. Use your vacuum with a brush attachment to accomplish that task. When you're done cleaning the filter, and you're done cleaning our inner filter here as well, you're going to put the tabs in the slots, and then you'll just press it back in there, and that'll hold it in place. And of course, you've got the bottom one here as well. Something else I want to cover also is our drip tray. We have a drip tray at the bottom of the unit, and that drip tray will occasionally collect condensation. And that condensation comes from the fact that the cooling nodes inside that do the cooling get so cold that under the right conditions, if we have fairly high humidity, what will happen is it will cool the air as it passes over the electronic node in there. It will cool the air beyond the dew point, cool it below it, and that water will condense out of the air and end up going in the bottom of the unit, and that's on the inside of the cabinet. There's a built-in drain on the inside of the cabinet that will direct the water down here into the tray, and this is a little low, so I can't really show you the tray, but the tray is removable. It has two keyhole slots, and you lift it up and pull it straight out, and you can dump that water and wipe that tray. Make sure you keep the tray clean, because if you don't clean it regularly, it can possibly develop a little bit of mold in there. And of course, mold's not a good thing, so we need to make sure that it's kept clean. Another thing that we can do, roughly again, every 6 months to 1 year, is we're going to actually remove this sheet metal back. We're going to go in here with a vacuum and a brush attachment, and we're going to clean everything that we can see. And it's vitally important that you unplug the unit before you begin to do that, because we're dealing with hazardous voltages inside the enclosure once we have this back off the unit. So, and also, here on the back, just to help you out, we have a rudimentary electronic diagram of the unit. It basically gives you an overview of how the unit works. It also contains our serial number and customer service contact information. Our phone number is on there so that you can reach us at any point if you have any questions or concerns. Alright, so I've turned this unit over. Now we have a really good view of the bottom of the unit. And I wanted to cover these legs a little bit, because we often get questions about these legs, and I'm going to help you to answer some of those. So as you can see, we have one, two, three pretty large legs, and then we've got this really tiny one that screws into the lower door hinge. Again, this is not, that leg is not attached to the body of the cooler. It actually screws into the hinge here. So when you get this unit, odds are going to be pretty good that that small leg here, and I'm going to take it off for you, just to give you a comparison, as you can see, it's considerably smaller than the big leg. Now, a lot of times this leg will be either packaged inside the unit or it's down in the box somewhere. If for some reason you just can't find it, it's not in the unit, it's not in the box, not in the packaging, you can call customer service. We'll gladly get you one of these out there. No problem. And also, you'll notice there are two threaded holes in this hinge. And the only one that's going to fit is going to be the one that's closest to the outboard side of the hinge here. So what you're going to do is you just start your thread, make sure you don't cross thread it, and then you can screw that in. Now what you're going to need to do is you need to get the unit on a flat surface, and once you get it on that flat surface, it's probably going to rock a little bit, so you're going to adjust this leg in or out to compensate for that. So what happens here is that the door, when it's open, that small leg will help to balance out the unit. The reason it's a smaller leg and it goes into the hinge is because the hinge takes up some of the real estate here for the big leg. So in order to compensate for that, they put a smaller leg in here, and we've got some threads in here for you to attach it. So that's the reason for it. And again, just as a reminder, if you are missing the leg, you're truly missing it, you can't find it, call us at customer service. Again, that number's on the back of the unit. We'll help to get you a replacement leg out there. I hope that this do-it-yourself video has helped you to set up and maintain your new TWR215ESS thermoelectric wine cooler. If you have any questions or concerns, please contact EdStar at www.edstar.com.